Hi, I'm Aisha with an I. And today I'm gonna teach you how to paint rocks to look like burrowing owls to save the burrowing owls. With me today, we have La Destiny.
Hello.
And La Miracle.
Hello.
They're sisters, and they don't know how to paint burrowing owl rocks. So by me showing them, that will teach you. All right, are you guys ready?
Ready. Let's get started.
Yes.
Step one for painting a burrowing owl rock is you need to find a picture of a burrowing owl that you connect with.
You can either use Google Images and search for burrowing owl face, or visit @SaveTheBurrowingOwl on Instagram, where I'm curating photos of the owls directly from their photographers.
I have picked a burrowing owl for us today. You can either print it out so that you can see it directly in front of you while you paint, or you can use your phone or your laptop to show yourself your picture of your owl. La Destiny, what does this owl make you think?
That he is serious about hunting its food, his food. He's on the lookout, and he's ready. He's watchful.
La Miracle, do you have anything to add?
He looks very watchful, like he's looking for something. In his vision, he's looking out for something serious.
Excellent. And by the time we were done painting our rocks, they should look something like this.
Before we start painting, here's an overview of the supplies we'll need, the steps we'll take, and why this project is important. We'll use a recyclable container with a lid, two recyclable containers half filled with water, one large brush and various small round brushes, paper bags and towels, white gesso, acrylic sealer, and acrylic paint. Black, yellow, navy blue, raw umber, burnt umber, gold, and bronze. But you can get by with just one brown, and you could use blue and mix in a little black and white gesso to create the navy blue. Oh yeah, and you'll need a Sharpie. If you don't have any supplies, I've put together an online Amazon shopping list of the exact supplies we'll use in this tutorial for your convenience. Use this URL to find it. I recommend these supplies if you've got a large group, a class, or if you want to paint a lot of rocks. Because it's a bit pricey, I did pick the cheapest products without sacrificing quality that can be delivered to you for free if you have Amazon Prime. I also put together this other Amazon shopping list of the minimal number of supplies you need. I recommend these supplies if you're painting alone, with a friend or partner, or if your kids would like to give it a try. It's half the cost, but you'll still get full quality products and be able to complete the lesson. It'll just be with less pizzazz. You'll notice if you use these URLs that Amazon will ask if you want to donate to a nonprofit. I humbly request that you choose my organization, Aisha with an I. It's my nonprofit that's funding my project to save the burrowing owls here in Silicon Valley, called The Guardian Project. If you follow this URL each time you shop at Amazon, Amazon will donate a portion of what you spend to my organization. We use most of that money to purchase plants for the owls. Amazon will donate 0.5% of eligible purchases. It costs an average of $11 to purchase one plant for our burrowing owl habitat, Burrowing Owl Billows in Shoreline Park. That means for every $2,200 that you spend at Amazon, Amazon will give us enough money to buy one plant for the burrowing owls. The burrowing owls are dying out because of habitat loss, mostly due to humans building buildings where they live. By planting more plants where they have left to live, the burrowing owls will have more to eat because they eat the bugs and small rodents that eat the plants that we plant. If you'd like to donate to us directly, for every $5 you donate to Aisha with an I on PayPal, I'll send you a sticker. For every $25 you donate, I'll send you a temporary tattoo sheet. Sign up for the mailing list if you'd like to get involved with planting the plants here in Silicon Valley. But painting rocks that look like burrowing owls is another direct way you can help them out no matter where you are in the world. Because the more people know and care about the burrowing owls, the more people will find ways to help. I'm going to show you how to paint a rock to look like a burrowing owl in 17 steps. But you can take as many breaks in between as you'd like and can spread the course over days. I show each step in detail for the absolute beginner, followed by troubleshooting. So refer to the timeline to skip around if you're experienced. Pause the video to complete steps if you're following along to learn alongside us. Now, let's paint.
All right, now that you've chosen your burrowing owl, we are going to choose a rock. This one. The reason we want to pick this rock is because it's smooth, it's the shape of a burrowing owl head, and it's light, because I don't want to get too big of a workout today. But Destiny wants a bicep workout today. Why else would you want to pick a larger rock?
Because I'll be able to fit all the features of the burrowing owl.
Excellent.
Is this one a smooth one?
That feels pretty good. Okay. The next step is to wash our rocks so the paint sticks and we also don't make our paintbrushes or paints full of dirt. So to do that, you first want to rinse your rock off, then just use some hand soap. Just a little bit will do. And then you wash your rock because it's going to be an owl. So treat it good, even though it's only a rock right now. And rinse it off. And because we washed our rock so well, we can actually just use our hand towel to dry it off. Now your canvas is ready for painting. Now that you've cleaned up your rock, we're gonna prime it using gesso. What we have here is recyclable container that you can put your paint in and cover so that you can save your paint for later or to stop it from drying out if you need to take a break. But as you can see here, this is all paint that's dried out. You do not want to wash your paint that you put on your palette down the sink. This paint is called acrylic. It's made of plastic. So that's why you don't want to put it down the sink because it could clog your pipes. That's why we put it on these. So when we're done, we put this in recycling because it's all plastic. Gesso is the primer we're going to use. It's acrylic primer. It'll make it so that we have a white base to build our owl off of. Whenever you use any paint, only start with a little bit. I'm picking a larger brush so I get the job done quicker. It doesn't need to be very detailed. The other thing to keep in mind is put down some kind of a paper underneath your work surface so in case you slip, you don't cover something that you don't want covered in paint. The other thing you need is a container to put your water in that you'll use to dilute your paint, which helps it spread better. Now I'm going to paint, and you only need to put some on the tip and then you spread it around, and this way you're not wasting any paint. Oh, I just got some on me. No problem, we're gonna wash our hands later. All right, that looks pretty good. After it's dry, which would be pretty quick because we're in the sun, we'll do the other side. In between, while you're not painting, dip your brush in the water to clean it off. We're gonna have two water containers. One will be to clean off the majority of the paint on your brush. And then the other one will be to prep it for painting again. Which you wanna do if you're not gonna be painting for a while because you don't want to let paint dry on your brush. But now that it's clean, we can leave it out. If you didn't get all the paint out, when you touch the bristles, it'll be cracky after it dries a bit. Now that we've let one side dry, we can flip our rocks over. To get into the holes, do like the speckling motion. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Like you're like patting the paint into the holes. Definitely watch out for the sides on both of your rocks.
What happens if you do too light of a coat?
You need to use more gesso.
Okay.
That or you wait till it dries and then do another layer. But you can see here now, like this is a solid coat.
Yeah, that's pretty.
After you're done painting your primer onto your rock, your water is probably gonna be looking a little bit like milk. And we're about to switch to use the color yellow, and we don't want our yellow ending up kind of white. So we're actually gonna dump our water down the sink, which is unlike when you clean your palette off. Because there's not that much acrylic paint in your water, it is okay to dump it down the sink. Now we're on to step five. We are going to put yellow on our rocks now to create eyes. Make sure you have a very little amount because we really don't need a lot of yellow. We're going to pick a different brush, dip your paintbrush into the water, then get your little bit of paint. Start with making the outline first. You can see how I used two different, for the top and bottom, two different strokes, and then I filled in the center. This is a technique we're gonna be using throughout the process. Lamiracle doesn't like how her eyes are offset to the side. So she is gonna show you how to fix them. You use some primer and you cover it up. Ta-da! Done. We just need to wait for it to dry again. La Destiny, explain to Lamiracle how to center your eyes properly.
Okay. One thing that you can do is just kind of use your hands and... make sure that there's room for the beak to go in between. So you look at the picture, but kind of like see where it is on our samples. And then... so I'm thinking like right here and right here. Looks good. Wait, maybe I should dot it. Just to move. Like that? Maybe.
Yeah, that looks good. Looks like you spread them out more. In the animal kingdom, what we call they just did is visualization.
The owls pass the day dust bathing, preening, and visualizing the evening's hunt.
Are you happier with your eyes?
Yes.
Now we're ready for step six, where we're gonna add the black pupils. I grabbed an even smaller brush because the black pupils are gonna fit inside the yellow irises. Because we're going a darker color, it's okay to use dirty water because yellow water is not gonna show up on black because the black is so strong. I'm only gonna use a very little amount, even less than the yellow. Very little. Waste not.
That's it.
Waste not.
A very little amount. All right, same technique. So we're gonna do two C's and then fill it in. Get a little bit more paint and do the other one. Looks like we need a little more water. That's how you can tell when you need more water, is that you'll see the texture of the rock more than you want to. All right. Perfect. And we're done. The other thing that is okay to do with your brush is to leave it in the water if you're gonna use it pretty soon after. Mm-hmm. You don't want it to dry out, but at the same time, you don't want to leave it in your water like for hours because you'll end up with a bent brush. Oh. Which may not be desirable, but you can also use that for certain techniques. What you can do to get that other side better is flip your rock around. Perfect, like that. And now fill in the side that's kind of messed up with the black. But see, it should be easier now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Perfect. So now you can also flip it upside down so you can get that bottom part, which is now the top part. Perfect, you got it. The rotation technique. Lamiracle's trying to use the back end of a paintbrush to stamp on her pupils. Looks like it's working. Was that successful?
Yes.
Excellent. So there you have it, friends. There's more than one way to paint a pupil. Now we are on to step seven, the beak. We're going to use this navy blue because that's often the color of a burrowing owl beak, so sometimes it's a little yellow, but you can see the navy blue here. We're just gonna do the whole beak with the blue though, for simplicity's sake. Again, only use a small amount because it will dry very quick, especially if you're in the sun like us. We're also going to use a small brush again. This is the same brush I used for the pupils. Add a little paint to your brush. And now we're gonna outline. This time we're gonna do an upside down open teardrop. This is what I mean. With two strokes, boom, we got our upside down. It's open teardrop because I'm not closing it. And now we're gonna actually clean our brush off, use the water on the brush to create, it's already dry. To create a gradient, that's not working. All right, we're gonna add a little more blue, very little amount because we're trying to create a gradient. There we go. And the other side, and we're gonna leave the center white.
Oh, that's so pretty.
We wanna try to blend it between the blue and the white. There we go. And if you see that it's getting a little too blue in the middle, dab it with water, take a paper towel. There we go. And there's your gradient. Oh my God, oh, it keeps drying. Let's add a little more blue again. There we go. That's pretty good. We are ready for step 8. We're gonna move on to, this is called raw umber, but really anything with umber is fine. If you wanted to use, for example, burnt umber, this is an okay color too, because if you look at our burrowing owl, it has both colors in its feathers. But really you just wanna stick to the umbers slash brown. But umber is a little more specific of a color. And you are an artist, after all. You need to be specific. We're gonna stick to raw umber. This time we can get a little bit more because we're gonna be doing the forehead. We're gonna use this brush, which is the one we use for the yellow eyes. Dip it in the water again before you take a little bit of paint. This time, so we're doing the whole forehead. But you want to leave room for the brow. So if we look at our burrowing owl brow, there are these white feathers that come into the dark area. So we're basically doing the negative space of those white feathers, which are overlapping the brown. So use the shape of your brush to dig in and be the space in between the white feathers. Whenever your brush dries out, add a little water. It's all a balancing act between water and paint. That's gonna be the edge of my brow. So I'm gonna circle back, connect it to my forehead. Let's go do the other brow. You'll see, because I'm right-handed, I'm gonna do it upside down because it is easier then. See, I'm very mindful of those way the little tufts of feathers that are white are overlapping the brown area. As you can see, my owl is becoming a little crooked. That is okay. He is a little crooked owl. I'm gonna connect this back. I can get those little cracks in. We're gonna leave the back white, but try to give it a more clean transition. Voila, and so there's our brow. You can see I kept the white eyebrows of the owl and made the forehead all dark brown.
Should I come from the side in with the angle? Because when I looked at it,
if you are really wanting to visualize it, just try using the water to see how it'll move with the brush on top of your rock. It'll dry instantly, but you'll see how the water will, like, how the paint will behave by looking at how the water behaves.
Okay, that makes sense. No.
Instead of, like, you're kind of sketching like you have a pencil, do more strokes, so you're like more confidence. Just be like, this is the stroke, and then this is the stroke.
Okay, we'll see.
There's gonna be a touch-up stage. So if your brows look like they did last time, we'll fix them.
Okay. You ready?
Yeah. So instead of like going back and forth with like less paint and less water on your brush, do longer, slower, and it lets it seep into the little holes on your rock. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah, it's still lighter.
We'll add a little more paint. But you see, when you go slow, you're not gonna have to go back again and do the stippling.
I'm starting off light first, then darken it. Just because when I do lighter, it helps me form the brow like thing better.
That's a good strategy.
I should just try, but I feel like...
Yeah, that looks good. Though it's kind of coming out like they're shooting straight out of his eye. Mm-hmm. Which is, it's, you know, it's a style. It's a style. It depends on whether you want to keep that style. You have the right idea when you're doing that first one, but then when you do that one, it's like you're cutting off any feathers that are going that direction.
Okay.
But again, remember, we can always clean it up with white at the end. So if you want to go that way, commit, and then we can change it if you want. But you might like it.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, they suck.
What?
Negative.
It's okay, you're learning. Don't be too harsh. Are you done?
Yeah. I'm ready for the next step.
You want to show us yours? Excellent. Now we're on to step 9, where we're going to continue with the umber, and we're going to do the chins and the cheeks. The chins, only one chin per owl. The cheek is going to go right under his eye and come up right below his brow. And what we're going to do is we're just going to do some straight, can like feather them. But you see how he has these little, like on his chin, or his, these are cheeks. We're gonna call them cheeks. The top of his cheeks, he has like these little brown feathers that flare out.
Right here, yes?
Yeah. You can see that they start shorter, they go longer, and they go shorter. So that's the thing you wanna keep in mind. But then the strokes themselves, they can be organic, we'll call them. So you can see I'm kind of doing it organically. And I'm using my pinky to help balance my brush. So I think that's pretty good for his little cheeks. I'm gonna even them out a little bit. You wanna let some white show through. He's got this little mouth that comes in next to his beak where the feathers are darker. We're gonna do that area. What that looks like is we have these two strokes that come out next to the beak. We're gonna do the other side. It's like you're making a little triangle, but the sides are caving in. It's his mouth. And now we'll go to the chin. If you notice on our owl, he's got feathers sticking out directly at us, really close to his beak. And then eventually they flatten when it reaches his body. So in order to pull that off with paint, we're gonna start with really thin lines. And I always like to do one, like a one that goes under the beak. And to make it go under, you pick up your brush and then finish the line on the other side. Let's get it a little bit more. All right, so we're gonna start thin. And to make it thinner, when you have a thicker brush, just use less pressure. And again, it's supposed to be organic, so if it's a broken line, that's okay. But the trick is you're swooping. You're swooping, you're going up, down, up. And you can see we're eventually gonna be doing full U's. I'm getting wider as I get further from his beak. I'm also, with the brush, I'm starting light and then I go down to make it heavier, use more pressure, and then I lighten it up again. You're creating like these layers. It's like we're layering a cake or something, but it's an owl. I don't know if that's a good metaphor. Like, what would you call that? That's not like a cake, but...
Looks like stairs to me.
Stairs?
It looks like waves.
Okay, waves. Or like sand dunes or something.
Yeah.
But you can see I'm getting bigger and bigger and bigger as I get further from the beak. And like some of the lines, they overlap with each other and some don't. That's how we give that organic feather look, is you want variety. And then on the edges, we can connect with our top brow and just go ahead and fill that area in. Looks like I need a little bit more paint. Here we go. Get this side. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Connect it all the way around. All right. You can see my owl's a little heavier on the right side. And connect it here. Fill it in. There we go. And there you have it. So that's step 9. We're doing the cheeks around the mouth and this chin area, and we connect to our top brow. Voila! Starting with the mouth would have been a better order.
I agree.
Should we take these out?
You don't want to use those ones? I can go wash them too.
Are they okay in the water?
They're okay. They're gonna be a little bit bent, but honestly, it's not a big deal. Don't worry about it.
Well, how does that happen?
See how they're like curved?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's just because like all the weight is on the side.
Okay, I have a question.
Yeah.
So like with mine, should I just do the mouth like right here and connect it?
Don't connect it. You mean to the eyeball?
No, you see how like it's yours like right here?
How's it connected to the cheek?
Okay, so like you see this opening. Should I start the first mouth?
Like, yeah, I would start it there, but like I was saying, like you actually don't want them connected. Like, that's a mistake on mine that I'm gonna have to fix with white.
No.
Because see how they're not connected here? Like, it's like, none
yeah,
of the...
I'm saying for the mouth.
For the mouth.
Mouth, should I start it from this opening to
yeah.
this crease?
Yes, yes. Okay. Yeah, that's a good guideline.
Is that the same brown or the different?
I think that's a different one.
Oh! I pulled that out, my bad.
Honestly, yeah, you could use either.
Which one you want to use?
This one I already put out. Oh, that's a lot. I'm nervous. You're going all the way across right now, right? You've got a few intersecting here, which is good. But like, let's show you one here. So we're gonna come up, push down to make it fatter, and then make it thinner again. We want some like dynamic variety. I'm leaving that white space for like a tuft of feathers to come through here. Here's another tuft that can come in here. But I mean, actually, you're just pretty good. Like, if anything, I would actually connect a few of these. So like, connect that one, we're gonna connect this one, we're gonna come up here, connect these ones. So now it's a little bit more organic, but we're also gonna go back in with the white too. And then you also wanna like connect up to this guy.
Help us out.
Actually like connect it solid so it's clean. I'm just gonna blend into our other color. Here, I'm gonna just blend it straight up. This is fine, I'd leave that. But then you can do the other side. You see how like I connected it?
Mm-hmm.
But you're basically almost done.
Cool.
Now we're ready for step number 10. We're gonna do our eyeliner, which ladies who like to wear makeup, this part should be no problem for you. So for the eyeliner, you can see on our owl, they have natural eyeliner, thanks to evolution. We're only gonna use a little bit of black again, because the eyeliner we don't need a lot for. Use the smallest brush we got. Oops. Dip around you. Load it up. And now you can see, like, the reason my brush is all curved is because we left them in the water, which is better than letting them dry out, but not as good as washing every single time in between, which can be annoying. So that's why we went ahead and left them in the water. Anyway, so we're actually gonna use this to our advantage, and it's like a little hook. And we are going to circle around the whole eyeball. And the trick to that is you keep your wrist really light. Circle around the whole eyeball. Can you see what I'm doing?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right, let's do the other eye.
Whoop.
You're so perfect. Like, I'll be shaking.
Part of the trick is you look ahead. I mean, apart from practice, it's like looking ahead to see where you want to go. Because if you look too much where your brush is touching, it'll start to shake. All right, so now that we have our eyes circled, we are not done yet. You can see that on our owl, he's got like, it flares out a little bit more on the bottom, and he's got like a little lip on the top. So let's go ahead and put that top lip in. There we go. See the top lip here. Let's make it a little thicker on the other side. That's the top eyelid. Let's see the bottom corner. Bottom. And then we're not done yet, because the other thing the owls have is, you'll notice here, his eyeliner actually leaks down, like he's got like a dragon eye. So we're gonna do that here, just like that. And that. Voila!
So pretty.
Oops, now that I'm facing it, it's a little bit lopsided. Nice. Aw, he looks so cute. Now that you can see his eye better, he looks kind of like an angry bird.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, connect. I'm trying to like line this with that.
Yeah, you got it. I think you could fill in that little, like, I would rotate your rock around because it'll be easier to get that little angle where you have a divot in your rock. Same. And get a little water on your brush too. Your brush is pretty dry. Only a little bit though. You don't want to go crazy. Yeah, there you go. How are we doing, La Destiny? Nice. I think you could use a little bit more water so you have a little more flow, so it's less chunky.
Okay.
He's got like a lot of chunky mascara.
I done gave Ma like an eyelash. I don't know what I did here.
I mean, it looks cute, but like I would do that to the other side too. Okay, okay. He's got a big low lash. It's like the 70s. Yeah, then balance them out so they look a little more even with each other. You could even go bigger on the top. Got those big cat eyes. Yeah, I'll connect it a little bit more.
Can you show me how to like line it? You see how like it's like, you know, when it's not smooth right there because the cracks in there?
Yeah.
I just want to like line it.
Here.
Like make a straighter line.
Here, let's trade. Let's make sure we have the right amount of water and paint on our brush. The biggest thing is like the angle, because I want it to be connected here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to start here and go slow and connect it. See how it's a straight line now?
Yeah, that's perfect.
It's because I'm not coming here and going across. I'm actually following the line of the brush.
Mm-hmm.
And like, see if I want to clean this up. I first angle the rock and the brush so they're aligned like that. And now you have a straight line. Let's do it here again too. Let's come around here and do this one. So the biggest trick is to make sure you're, it's almost like I'm coming towards where the stem of the brush is. And that's what's gonna give me a straighter line. So here, let's straighten this one too. Actually, see, I'm still gonna be, even though I changed the angle of my hand, I'm still coming towards the base of the brush.
Mm-hmm.
Towards the base. Fix this one too. There you go. For your one line, because you are so close to the cheek, bring out very small where my thumbnail is. Do you see?
Yeah.
And then just come short of the cheek. Don't touch the cheek.
Should I just start like at that little point right here?
Yep. Okay. Yeah, yeah. Start at that little corner of the eye. And the other thing too, like on this one's gonna be a little trickier. Yeah. Go ahead and intersect the part of that brown beak part, because we'll go back in with white and we'll clean it up.
So gonna connect it to the beak.
Yeah, it's okay if it connects, because we'll go with white to like make sure they separate again. How's it going, LaDestiny? Any questions? Yeah, I think your one on the left is better, so that means you're getting better. Now that you're done with the black eyeliner, our next step, step 11, involves using white gesso again. Look how dirty our water is. We don't want our gesso to turn out kind of with a brown tinge, so it's time to clean out our water.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now that we've got clear water again, thank you to La Miracle this time for doing water duty. We're gonna move on to white gesso. The reason you wanna use white gesso instead of white paint is because it's opaque. White acrylic paint will like allow you to see through, but the opaque will allow you to cover up. That's why we're using it. It allows us to paint on top of the dark brown, which is the step we're doing next. For this one, you're gonna wanna grab a round brush. You have to pay a lot of attention to the technique I use with the brush, because we're going to use the shape of the brush to make these feathers that come out of the burrowing owl's forehead. And for this, you stamp it and you press it. Let me show that again. This is like the shape of the brush. We're like basically using the brush as a stamp to be the shape of that feather. What you gotta pay attention to here is it flares out from the forehead. So this is one of the lines that we'll flare out from. We're gonna go next to it.
That looks so good.
Yeah, that's why it's my favorite. It's just like
pretty.
It's pretty. It's quick too. That's
I just add like extra
I
just 5 minutes.
I'm gonna add like. Yeah, I know. I was gonna say it's like maybe it's like all the steps. Whatever I do, they're pretty quick. But you can see, you can come all the way down the side.
Like that. We can space it out more than that.
I'm doing it like pretty organized.
Yeah.
But you can actually do it kind of like here. Let me branch out, and make it a little bit more organic. You can have pieces touch each other, because if you look at the actual owl. Like, they're not even as perfect as what I'm doing it here, where they're like these perfect little teardrops. I keep calling them teardrops. Because the owls are sad that they're dying, guys. That's why they're teardrops. But. So you can see now I'm like getting a little looser with it.
Get loose with it.
Get loose. It's still pretty organized. I'm like trying to make it unorganized and it's still organized.
It looks so pretty. I like it organized.
But you guys can see now how it's like I'm using it basically as like a stamp, or how La Miracle is doing her eyes, but using the side of the brush. That's why you need to use the round brush, because that's what's going to give you the shape. And it come down the side of the face. And then after you're done with your brush, just remember to pick up the habit of getting all the paint off of it. And then laying it flat. Let's see if we can implement that new habit.
Should I put the whole white on the whole brush?
Use only like the the top third.
It's like by the time I get it, it'd be just the shape be off from when you did it.
I mean, once you stamp it, you'll start seeing it looks a little other way. So like, yeah, like that. So the fat end is at the top. And then the lighter you do it, the smaller your feather would be. And then the heavier hand you use, the fatter. Perfect. What? Looks fine. It looks perfect.
I just goofy.
Uh-oh, it does near mask. We can't show people this. There we go.
That would be the first thing they say. They wouldn't even care about the video. Yeah,
they'll be like, where's her mask?
I can't watch this. I'm gonna get it through the computer.
Who is setting a bad example? Everyone is wearing their mask. Except Megan!
We need to protect our black women.
Are these looking okay?
Yeah. Yeah, they look good.
I don't think you can really mess up on this part.
I disagree.
We are on to step number 12. This is a fun step because we really get to work in and fix anything that kind of bothered us before to really make this owl pop. We're doing white textured feathers on the chin, the beak, and the cheeks. We're going back in with our gesso white because it is opaque. The first thing I want to do is I want to make sure I get those white rings around the eyes that our owl has. You can see here on his cheek, this connects into a circle, and we don't have that. So we're going to go and we're going to add it on top. Add it there. You can see I'm going very light with the brush, so I'm keeping that feather texture. I want to make sure I connect it here too. Again, the way that you want to move with the brush is towards your wrist. Actually, we got to separate these guys a bit. So I just added that white in between. You guys see how it's like cleaning it up?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So it does quite
like
a lot.
The other coat.
Yeah.
And it gives that.
And like here I can fix this little area where it came off. Add a little white back in. Okay, so now I just cleaned up the cheek area. Next area I want to add like a feather texture to is this chin. Again, it's a texture with the brush where I'm like dabbing.
Dab.
Stop!
It's giving it like this feathery look. It's just everywhere that already has white, I'm dabbing. But you see how the texture of the brush
yeah.
is really what's giving it that, it's like fluffy.
Oh wow.
It's like you wanna like cuddle him. And the lighter you do it, the more you're gonna get a feathery appearance. And oops.
Now what's the paint to water ratio with this?
So on this one, you're actually a little heavier on the paint. You also don't want huge, like thick globs of paint though, because it's gonna take forever to dry. You can even add some additional white parts in here. Like I'm like, oh, he needs like a few more feathers. But that's pretty good. Let me come back in here. They should all look like feathers. Make sure you don't hit your beak. All right, so then that's the chin area. For the area around the beak, I'm actually going to switch brushes to a lighter brush. Make sure it's like thin. For this part, let's take a look at our sample owl one more time. Let me explain it. But you see how he's got these like white feathers that curl towards the beak and then they come out and they feather out? We're going to make those. So be really light with your hands, and we're gonna cover up a little bit of that brown mouth area that we pulled out. Remember, these are feathers, so very light. We can even go a little on top of the beak just to break up that teardrop so it's not so teardroppy looking. And then voila.
I'm gonna add a little bit more to this. The brow itself looks a little bit too stiff. So we're actually gonna give that feather texture also to the brow by coming in and kind of breaking up. And see how I'm flicking the brush? That gives it, again, that light, like it's feathers, and it's not fur, it's not plastic, it's feather texture. Here, I can fix some parts too by doing that. There we go. And there have it.
They made a huge difference.
Yeah.
Huge.
Nice. Should I add a little
brown? So, yeah, like what I was just telling the Destiny is your focus right now is you want to break up all those thick lines you have and make them feathered. So that way we don't have any real solid lines.
So mine don't look feathered?
No, yours are good. You just want to keep going. You see how these are still like kind of solid lines? Like feather up their borders a little bit more.
Should I add a brown line again right here?
You can, but we are going to go back in with like bronze and gold. So like that's when you can touch it up again. If anything, like you still need to work on your guy's right side cheek.
I'm confused on you.
Here, let me just see your brush for a second. There should be like a white between these two. And like you can make sure you blend it like that. Blend down here a little bit more. There you go. See how he has more of a cheek now?
Yeah. But should I do that with this?
You do, yeah, when you want it on this side as well.
And then go like.
Yeah, perfect. And for La Destiny, what I would do is like, you got the right flick, but flick out from the eye to the, because that's you want to move your brush in the same direction as the feathers. As like the feathers grow, and they grow out of the eye.
I hate mine.
What? It looks good.
The feathers. I don't like this part.
I think you gotta break up your border a little bit more with a little bit more of a pink white.
Where?
You can still see where there's a solid brown line underneath the paint. Mm-hmm. So you need to use a little bit more opaque paint, which means less water, and then break up that border. So you can't see that it's just a straight paint line. And it's okay to have some of it show through, that's okay, but you don't want too much. So you can see that this line continues all the way. That's not very like natural for the owl. So we're gonna break it up, put white there, put white there, put white there, put white there. But this is a good way to do it because this line, you do want it to continue. You just don't want it to be connected. There you go. See, now that looks a little bit more natural. So if you look at the photo, you look at your owl, they actually look more, right?
Yeah.
And actually, because we have more white, I'm gonna cover up this spot here because I can see your eyeball.
The yellow one.
Yeah, there we go. And that doesn't make sense when I say break up the boundary or the border. You want to break
but
it.
But like covered it a little bit?
Not cover it, but like make it more feathery. Like, so now that there's like, this part looks like it's got feathers. Versus this side, it's
perfect
too straight.
Stitch,
yeah. It's like a printing of an owl, not an actual owl. And then you still have to do the beak.
Okay.
Yeah, that's good. Nice.
Yeah. Cute. All right.
Cutie. We're on to step number 13, which is another favorite step of mine because this is the moment where for very little effort, we add a lot of bang. You're still gonna be using your white. We're gonna add a highlight to the eyeball. Get a little white on the tip of a round brush. This one you should use a round brush for. And now we're gonna say the sun's gonna come from one direction. We're gonna say this direction, which means gonna add a little dot there, little dot there, and do a little smaller dot next to it, a little smaller dot next to it. And then now it looks like his eyes are glossy. Yeah. Nice. Cute. See, it looks like they're little anime characters. You did your light source like the light's coming straight at him.
Oh wait, I did?
It's okay, it's cute. It just makes him a little like a little bit more goofy looking.
As if it wasn't already.
Yeah.
We're on to step number 15. We're gonna go ahead and skip step number 14 for now, because I don't think either of you are gonna want to do step number 14. Anyway, this is the step where we go back with any of the colors of paint that we want in order to fix problems that we noticed along the way, or because we want to enhance certain features. So this is also the step where we'll go in with gold or bronze to add some highlights. So for looking at my owl, I already see a mistake, and I want to show you that I'm going to just go ahead and fix it. Where's the little brush?
This one?
Yes, let me use this one. All right, so the mistake I see is that the black line should not connect to the cheek. So I'm gonna go ahead and fix that. This is not anatomically correct. All right, so I just fixed that. I wanna balance it on this side. I also kinda wanna like make it more of, like I feel like I need to break up some of my lines too, so it blends better into the cheeks. What else do I wanna fix? You know, other than that, I do think I want to add a little bit more of a feather next to his beak. There we go. And then I actually want to fix up my eyeliner. Looks like it kind of got away from my owl, so I'm going to go in, tighten that up. Pull this guy in. And let's make, I don't know what's going on, he's got like three eyelids. Get rid of that. We're gonna balance it out the other side. What's really great about using the gesso is it's so opaque that I can just completely cover up the black that I don't want anymore.
Man, that's what I love about you. It's like you're a black dude, but you don't act black.
Carve away at it. So now these eyes are a lot more balanced, except for now, like, look at those lines. We're gonna just go and pull this one in. His, like, dragon eyeliner. There we go. So now that's more balanced. His beak, let's go on his beak. I want more of like a, I want to actually cut it in more so it's more of a point. I'm gonna do that with the white. So that way it's got more of a point. And in terms of corrections, I think that's pretty good. And what I want to do next, actually, is go in with gold. I'm going to grab gold here.
I love gold!
I'm actually going to grab a bigger brush, too. And I'm going to add some highlights to his cheeks. Space them out a little so it's just not solid gold. This way he's shiny in the light. I'm gonna add like a little to the brown areas here. So he'll glimmer in the sunlight.
People would know we're different. What I am.
It's like diamonds. You're beautiful.
Like the beautiful owl he is. I guess he's a he. My owl is a boy owl. And you know what? I want to make him a little bit more fancy.
I'm gonna go in, and you can see I'm not being super technical with the gold and stuff because it's pretty translucent. I'm gonna go in with the bronze. As well, and dabble it. Make them shiny. Makes it a little bit more dynamic. It's also fun to do because it's hard to mess up. Just gonna add a little to his forehead in the middle. So the center of his forehead pops a little bit more. But you know, this part is like all optional, so if you don't wanna have any gold shimmering highlights on your owl, you don't have to. Your owl is technically done at this point. And voila! I think I'm done here. And now, step 15 is complete.
Can I fix this?
I would flip your rock upside down and then use the white to like just smooth out that border.
Which part was it?
Oh.
I suck at straight lines.
Some is practice, but you can also put your pinky on your rock to steady your hand. It's okay. It actually kind of follows your black line now. It might be because your rock's like that. And you also, you know, like wait for it to dry and go back in with the black. That's the thing about the polish phase, is like, it only ends when you're ready for it to end.
Actually, it looks fine.
Yeah, I think it's fine.
You're so red.
Yeah. Do that eye look crocod?
I think
I line this one?
Honestly, it's fine either way. Up to you. Because it's the polish phase, it's like, as an outsider, I'll say, like, it's done. And it's up to you to be like, no, now it's done.
Oh, I see where you're going with that. I say when I'm dead, I can be working on this for 3 weeks if I wanted
to. Right. Yeah, you could.
Wow, Matt. Well, look what I did.
Oh. Well, you can either wipe it away with a little water on a cloth, or go back in with the brown. Get your cloth a little wet though. A little bit, not too much. Because you don't want to scrape off all the paint.
Let's get it right here. Pat it or wipe it?
Wipe it. There you go, see, now it's come off. But if you wipe it too much, you're gonna, yeah, that's perfect. It makes like his cheeks look super fluffy the way you did his eyeliner now. Like it's like coming out you like a little pooch. Like it's pinchable. That's cute. Let's talk about cleaning our brushes. Yeah, use a little bit of hand soap. Once the water runs clear, that's when you know you got all the paint out. And then shape the ends back into a point, and then you're done. Before I spray to seal the deal, we're gonna write down how to paint rocks to .savethebrowingowl.org. And that will redirect people to this video so that they can learn how to paint rocks to save the burrowing owls. And then if they follow this step, more people will find how to paint rocks to save burrowing owls. It could be very fun to get all these people involved. So join me. We're gonna use a Sharpie for this because that way we can write very clearly. Here we go. And the trick here is, how do you get all the words
on the rock without squishing them. Here you can see I messed up. Burrowing owl. Or if you want, you could paint this part over in white, like the owl, and do owl.org here. You know, I think it's okay. Like, it's an owl. If anything, this should give people a chuckle.
As an add bonus, you can add hashtags to your rock. In my neighborhood, any rocks that people paint and put out for others to see are hashtagged with MV_rocks. All the burrowing owl rocks that you will be able to see from anyone who follows this tutorial should be hashtagged burrowing owls rock. And then you can see the collection of what everyone has contributed.
We're now going to spray our rocks with a matte finish. This is an acrylic sealer, and that's so that our rocks are weatherproofed and hopefully other rock-proofed, since they'll be hanging out with the other rocks in the wild. So this will help us make sure our rocks stick around for a while.
This is what happens if you don't use a sealer. You can see here that the paint is flaking off. And it's getting all over stuff that would otherwise decompose. And that is why we use a sealer.
Oh, we gotta make sure we mix that real good. What you see here is I have put all of my rocks inside of paper bags. And that way I'm gonna spray inside the bag and not get the stuff everywhere. What we're gonna do is we're gonna do 3 light coats on both sides, get at least one that goes around the rim, and we have to let it dry in between coats. And the trick with this is you don't wanna do one heavy coat, you wanna do several light coats. Otherwise, it actually doesn't work as well. Like, you don't have a hard finish that actually protects your rock. Just, if you've ever done your nails with nail polish, you'll notice that it's the same idea, because if you just do one glob of really thick polish, days later you can still leave a fingerprint indent in your nail polish. Same thing will happen to your rock. All right, ready to spray. You want to hold it about 10 to 12 inches away from your rock, but I want to make sure my canister is inside the bag so I don't spray anywhere outside of it. And here we go. That's one layer. Let's do the other one. Shake in between. Make sure everything stays loosey-goosey. You can also see I'm kind of getting in an angle because the rocks are needing to get completely covered all the way around. But we're doing several coats, so we should be good. It's good enough for now. And now we wait. Just want to show you this trick I did. So to get the sides, after I sprayed both of the flat sides 3 times each, I made a little fire pit so I can get the edges. I'll spray those 3 times each, and then I'll flip around and do the other side of the edges, and then we're done. This is Le Miracle's finished burrowing owl stone. What did you think of painting a burrowing owl rock?
It was fun, really, really fun. I never painted an owl before, so that was interesting. I think I did okay with a good teacher. She did really good at teaching.
What did you learn?
I learned how to steady my hand, how to hold the brush. I learned how to make an owl. I also learned how to not put too much pressure on the brush and just let it, just guide it through, and using the shape of the brushes when painting.
And if someone asks, why did you paint a burrowing owl, what would you say?
To help save our owls and to get the word out.
All right, LaDestiny, let's show everyone your finished owl. What are you most proud of in your owl?
Wow. It would have to be... I'm proud of it all. It's a holistic thing. It's a process. But I would say the eyes. I love how unique the twinkle in its eyes, as well as the thickening of the liner. I feel like it gave it some character and personality, you know, in comparison to its tiny nose. So, yeah.
Very nice. Do you have anything to say to anyone about why they might want to paint a rock that looks like an owl?
Well, if you care about burrowing owls, if you care about their habitat, if you care about their population and making sure that your kids and your kids' kids can enjoy this beautiful creature, then it's important to learn more about it, especially if you're in the Silicon Valley area, to understand that these precious creatures are at risk. And outreach like this is very important. It's just very important to be more in tune with the creatures around us. Also, because my friend, this is her baby, her passion project. I planted before and I went to actually see the owls myself and fell more in love with this project. And so hopefully that this can get this message and this passion project, the purpose and the vision will be spread amongst everyone here and to be connected to the burrowing owls. That was long-winded, but yeah, save the burrowing owls.
Done! Cute, very cute. And that is how you paint rocks to look like burrowing owls, to save the burrowing owls. How we do, guys?
We did great. He's so adorable.
Look at her.
Aisha with an I is out. Are you hot?
Very.
Are you enjoying yourself?
Yes.
Yeah, so cool. Oh yeah, invisible drums. Da da da. Oh, she's hitting the toms. Here comes a roll. Here it comes. She's boom, crash. Woo! The crowd goes crazy.